Hello, Mika in upstate New York, and Mika Rottenberg and Mahyad Tousi in downtown LA or somewhere in LA.
In the hills.
In the hills. In the hills, above Los Angeles. Well, this is a really auspicious time to be talking to you. You've been working for a couple of years on your first feature film, Remote. And it's been premiering in around the world, in North America, and now in cities across the UK. But let's backtrack a little bit first. Could I ask when you actually first got to know each other?
I think it was the party. yeah, it was a non-Thanksgiving party.
Yeah, I used to have
people that don't have family around, and exactly. You know, it was like everybody that was like kind of gathered from the streets, and I happened to be there, and also I happened to kind of wish I was about to started this big project, Cheese, and I was like kind of asking the universe to meet a DP, mm-hmm. And that evening, you know, I happened to go to Mayad's house and apartment, and he was like, oh, I'm a DP. It's like, oh, great, there we go. So it was a great night.
And how did you sort of come together more specifically to start to develop the ideas for the film?
Well, this was in 2023 or 20, well, maybe 25. So almost 20 years ago. 2005. Sorry, yeah. I keep saying that. Yeah, 2005.
We're living in the timeline of the film.
Yeah, Remote may be set in the near future, but
the future past. Yeah.
Yeah, it'll take us some time to recover from that timeline, but yeah, we. I mean, I think that first night that we met, we actually talked about making a film. And it was like, okay, so yeah, we'll make a film, and we talked about like a scripted film, because Mika was like, I want to make a film. I'm like, you want to film, like, make like a scripted film? She's like, yeah, I want to make like a scripted film. I'm like, oh, cool. And so we were like, you know, but you know, we were kids, and obviously, you know, it was a conversation that stuck around because you know, through what, 4 or 5 collaborations on Mika's pieces, where I was the cinematographer on, and then years after, as sort of we're doing our own thing, it stuck around. And then when COVID came, Mika called and said, hey, perhaps now is the time. And, you know, it was like, I think it was the week we'd gone to lockdown. It was that Thursday, I think, the Thursday after lockdown.
It's a delusional state of like nothing is possible and everything is possible at the same time.
Yeah.
And then how did the, because you're both in very different ways. I mean, you work with the moving image, but coming from slightly different, you know, parts of that world. But in a way, I think you're both storytellers, right? So how do you come together to kind of, you know, create this storyline between the two of you? How did that develop?
I mean, look, for me, if I've done anything in my career has been to sort of try to shirk any, to be pigeonholed. Like that's, I'm a person who's avoided being pigeonholed that's always front and center for me. So I've done all sorts of things. I was a conflict zone cinematographer. I worked with Mika on her projects. You know, I did independent films. I've done, you know, as commercial as it gets, the American sitcom, primetime television. I've done fantasy, sci-fi, you name it, virtual reality. So I try really, really hard, documentary, you know, really, really hard to sort of just continue to expand. So yeah, I would certainly call myself a storyteller because I would like to tell stories in all the different ways that I can possibly tell. And so for me, sort of being, it's a very natural process of being in a new situation, for sure. It was exciting. And also we had a track record, Mika and I. We had a common language that we developed over the 5 projects that we worked together. I had lived, you know, I had this amazing opportunity to be in the front seat into one of the places most people want to be, which is inside of Mika's head, you know, and see how she works. And that's an honor and a privilege. And it was so exciting, the idea of actually trying to think and build a world in that space was, it's just too good to pass up, you know.
Mika, well, I'm not sure you really want to be in my head, but
what was going on in your head in those first days and weeks of lockdown?
Well, I've been, you know, wanting to expand the way I make my work. So I felt like this format that I've been working in, these like 20 minutes, 30 minutes, kind of visual stories of visual places, because I see them more as places than as stories. And I really distinctly say that they don't develop in time, they develop in space, they're spatial, time-based things. So it was interesting to me to think about how they would develop in time, which is like a more classic story, like what happens if they do develop in time, like to add that. And I always said I want to make a film, and I always said that I want to collaborate, especially with someone that more comes from like storytelling and writing. And Mahyad was always, you know, a dream to actually collaborate with him on that level, because I, you know, I knew that like his ideas are brilliant, and that we also could like, you know, get along, and also that, you know, he won't just go with what I want to do, like he'll push back, you know, because I think. It's hard to really have an equal collaboration with people. So I think, although of course, you know, I wish he didn't hear it, but of course I want to do what I want to do. But I knew with him, it's not going to be just kind of following along. It would be like an equal collaboration. So as hard as it was, that was part of the thing. So yeah, we started talking. Of course, it was like, oh yeah, we do like a tiny, I think James, you're in the picture at that point. Oh, it would be like a very, like, very small thing, you know? And of course, like you can't, you know, that was not something that we could do. I think small. So immediately kind of just started dreaming about the script and the story, and we did an outline, and then, you know, Mahyad developed it into a script, and we worked very closely, you know, developing that. And 2 years later, also we were a little bit delusional, as James might know, about how long it will take. We're like, oh yeah, of course we could do it in, you know, 8-9 months. But, you know, 2 years later, that is the minimum time it took, which is normal even for a feature that has the kind of support. But we're, you know, both the producers, you know, the drivers, the interns, and directors and editors and all that. Like we played like a million roles. And also we, you know, it was very, the moment we actually wrote the script and knowing better, doing something with so much special effects and graphic layers, it's my nightmare. I did it before and I said, I'll never do it again. And, you know, there we are. So we just both knew that we're getting into something that would be really complicated to execute. But at that point, when you're like really excited about something, it's really hard to pull back. So we're like, we'll just do it. And I don't think there's that many people that actually could stay like engaged in something and, you know, not give up until the last minute. I mean, a few days before we did the final file, we were like, you know, working on the end, and it was, and we're both very, very, I think, obsessive, stubborn people. So I think that was thanks to that, we were actually able to make something that's the thing, you know? I mean, I feel like it's a movie. It's an hour and a half movie that kind of stands a cohesive thing.
I like what you just said, Mika, which is this notion that, and it's really true. It's like, I mean, I would say like it's the flip side that is true, right? The thing that drives you is if you don't like the thing you're doing, like if you don't like the story you're telling, if you don't like the project, like you want to see it, you want to desperately see how it ends, how it, you know, how it comes together, how you can solve it, because, you know, making movies is like a puzzle to be solved. you know, you can write it on paper and then you're like, okay, how the hell do you actually execute this thing? And with what you have, so that's part of it. But ultimately the thing that keeps you going is this obsessive love for this thing that you want to see finished. And if you don't have that, then it's not a fun job. But if you have that, then you have that drive and you push through. But I mean, the thing that's definitely true about this project is both of us just really, really liked it. You know, we really liked seeing it through, really like seeing what happens. Because, you know, at some point the project has a mind of its own and starts sort of growing in its own terms, like a teenager. And then you have to just sort of contend with, you know, between where you want it to go and where it needs to go based on the parameters that it's living under. So that process, that evolution, that that flowering, if you would, was a joy. And that's, I think, why the reason we're here and we still like each other, which is the important thing, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it was fun. The parts where we actually got to do the work was great. I mean, there's a lot of stuff under and around that's like, blah, you don't want. But when it actually gets to making it and solving it and you know, moving things around and all that, it's very satisfying.
I mean, you talked, Mika, about the kind of very long period of post-production, you know, with the editing. I mean, you gave yourselves a very kind of challenging kind of mission, really, which was to kind of create a sort of a film which integrates these different platforms somehow in the near future in a way which is really quite, I mean, to me, it comes across as being very credible. You know, these characters are living on their own, but they have found a way of communicating. And actually, to me, there's something quite optimistic about the film. You know, it's not that they're sad because they're living on their own. They've found a way of creating their own lives and a community, which I think is, you know, is really beautifully, you know, developed.
Yeah, I think it's how we went through also the isolation of the pandemic. Like I felt like we had so many magical moments of connection, first developing it and then connecting with people and meeting so many people all through Zoom, all staying in the same place, not really moving, and then mentally just going to so many places. And it really felt really magical and really special.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is the experience has been as people are seeing it now. I mean, look, you create this thing and then the really exciting part is actually what people do with it, how it affects people. And what's been really interesting since day one, when we showed it in Montreal and then the same in Los Angeles and now here in the UK, it's this idea that normally a film comes from a spark that is unknown to the viewer. You know, you're seeing the result of that spark, but the motivations, the conditions out of which a story comes out of, or a film or a piece of work comes out of is unknown to the viewer. In this case, it's coming out of a shared experience. We all went through the last 2 years, 2.5 years of COVID and everything else that happened in our world politically and otherwise. And so we all sort of experienced the same spark, the same common shared experience. And this film is very much the way we coped with that. This was our catharsis. This is how we survived the pandemic and everything else. That was 2020 for us in the US. But I think in the UK, you guys were going through some of the same stuff. And so this is the first time I've had the experience of actually showing a piece of work that the audience understands where it comes from, understands what it's trying to unravel and what it's trying to solve. Ultimately, as artists, what we're trying to do is deal with our own shit, you know, and solve our own problems. And hopefully, if we're lucky and you do it well enough, then perhaps other people can find some stuff inside of it. And here we have a baby, which is
not my baby, but we have a baby here.
This is a baby of our remarkable costume
designer. Yeah, actually, how we met,
dear friend, and how we met.
Yeah,
yeah. The incredible artist Lale Khoramian, and her daughter Arya. So anyway, so that I think was really interesting. And going through it, you know, we were, you know, there is this concept. It's called collective effervescence. I don't know if you're familiar with that idea, but
it's
It's sort of this notion, I think some sociologist Durkheim actually sort of coined it, and it was this idea of a sense of energy and harmony when people come together in a group around a shared purpose. And it was both like the thing that clearly was missing because of the pandemic and the lockdowns. And it was also the thing, because the thing that's missing becomes the thing that's so ever present, and you realize that's what you need and that's what you want, and that desire. And for us, for Mika and I, this like we had this our own like two introverts like having their own shared effervescence around making this film for the last 2.5 years. Like, you know, like it became a ritual that we got into. But I think ultimately that's what the film is about in some extent. So this notion of shared effervescence that so many of us need, and we became so aware of, keenly aware of during the pandemic.
I mean, Mika, for people who are watching, who are familiar with your early work, they'll know that the kind of the fingers and hands and that sort of tactile kind of world is somehow always often very present. So there's a kind of interesting paradox there, because at a certain point, you know, our lives were more disembodied probably than they had been before. Mm-hmm. You kind of created a world where people are living on their world, but somehow they connect in a tactile way.
Yeah, I think a lot of it, thinking about the hand, like from early on, I think that the hand is this kind of primary tool. And now it's like, I mean, if you see this baby, like, she keeps pointing, you know, it's like such a thing. And then now that how we're like, keep, you know, touching this, like, you know, tactileness, or I mean, smooth surface, I think there's like this thirst for textures and for, you know, materials. And we experience so much of it through these super smooth surfaces. Yeah, like everything is so smooth that. I think there was something about that working with that touch and the fingers, and that's kind of how they connect. And it was really when the pandemic was at the height. So with the idea of like them actually touching, I think we kind of forgot about it so fast, but the idea of touching another person, you know, that you don't live with, is like such a thing. It's amazing how quick we adapt to something. And then how quick we also, you know, adapt to something else. So that was definitely a moment.
And the other motif that, I mean, is the motif, if you like, of the hole here, in the holes in the five apartments, which are kind of like portals, except again, these ones, they get looked through, and then in the end, they get sort of reach through, as if to break this kind of this super smooth surface, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. It's overpassing. It's almost. I think we talked earlier on about using technology to overcome technology. That we needed to come to this moment through technology to discover something that's maybe a different kind of technology, but it's not dependent on that kind of technology that we're familiar with. So that's why they all live on this, right? Spoiler alert, I don't know, but that's why they're also like, you have to get somewhere in order to you know, descend from it. It's like the most physical, if you want, in order to kind of break from physical restraints, you have to kind of work through your max in order to go above like physics or something, you know. I think it's more like new agey kind of metaphysical idea.
And then I think there's this notion you know, we in some way are the designers of our own cages. You know, we've built the spaces and the environments that which we dwell in, and not necessarily cages, because we love our cages. It's our little cocoons, but we, in doing so, we begin to really become attached to these barriers, to these borders, to these extremities. And I think to some extent, the idea is always this push and pull between existing within these cocoons, within these contained spaces, but also finding ways to reach past them and reach through them. And And for us, in so many ways, this was about sort of, you know, when push comes to shove, everything is at your disposal, like the technology that's around you, your humanity, but even also the things that are so innate, like, you know, your nails continue to grow. Why? You know, and, you know, that even that extension, you know, of your nail, your hair, or the extension of your fingers, which is so primal, becomes ways of trying to transcend these environments that we're within, both spiritually, metaphysically, but also practically and physically, in order to attain something else, in order to reach something else, to reach forward, reach backwards, however you want to interpret it, but to reach beyond.
One word that you know has been aimed at the environment that you've the world you've created is this phrase solarpunk. Is that something that is that a phrase that you embrace? And if so, what does it mean to you?
Oh, solarpunk! I love. It's one of my favorite things, and it was really exciting when we could bring it into this environment. There is a few things that I've been obsessed with. Solarpunk being one of them, the way Kisho Tengetsu, which is a story structure that is used commonly in Japan, but comes from a Chinese poetic form, is another one, which is the way this film is structured. Solarpunk is a vision of the future that is where we begin to design and create and exist within aesthetics that are more in line and symbiotic with nature, not because there is some sort of an agenda, but because it's the better way to do it, because it is the better way. It's also more visually striking, aesthetically superior in every way. It's that solarpunk to me, and solarpunk is a movement that is both within storytelling, but also within architecture and design and what have you. And I think the optimism that you talk about, you know, what we didn't want to do was to create a, this has been the most satisfying thing that I've heard is people picking up on the fact that it's optimistic, but not only optimistic, because it's also realistic to some extent. Although we did not by any means try to say, oh, look, we're going to create a predictive story that actually tries to sort of be correct, but we want it to feel real. And I think that comes from the fact that we are continuously living in both a dystopia and a utopia. It's just our perspective at any given moment, but also our position within society. And so and if you think of it that way, then you can always push towards aspire towards things that are more utopian. And solarpunk certainly is an aesthetic that aspires towards more of a utopian and hopeful world, both aesthetically and otherwise.
Mika, do you have anything to add to that? About the solarpunk aesthetic?
Yeah, I think we tried in general to layer the movie as much as possible. So thinking about the storyline that's kind of threaded through as one layer, and then as many layers as possible, like within that. So, which how I like to think about my work anyways is, cross section, like going inwards, but then having something to go and, you know, I think my head really related to that. So like how many things we could kind of layer through. And so solarpunk was one of them. We had a lot more. I mean, we were like talking so much about work and what it means, the future of work. And, you know, I think if we had more time and more budget, we would have done a lot more. But at some point we were like, okay, like there was this thing of like not spreading too thin was like an obsession of mine. It was like, let's do something that's ambitious but possible enough, because what I really don't like is, you know, to promise all these things and then you're delivered something that doesn't communicate. And I hope it communicates at least a few of the layers that we thought about. And I think setting it in the near future, that was Mahyad's kind of like solution for some things, because we could get away with all these things if it is set in the future, near future. So the stairs.
I mean, it's interesting. The idea, it's like so many ideas that we ended up pulling back in. Look, I think what the layering is really critical, as Mika says, because you don't need to deliver, like there are things that are delivered at different layers, but in terms of the visuals that you see, the backgrounds of her life, and so you can pick up all these clues and they're not on the nose, but if you keep watching the film, you begin to see there's so much there. And all of these things that we ended up pulling back from that Mika's talking about ultimately are all there. They're just not front and center. They're not all competing for attention. And I think that's what actually makes it so much nicer. I'm glad some of these things fell behind because we didn't have time or money, because they're present, but they're not competing for attention. But people have been picking up on it, which is what's been the most surprising and enjoyable things. It was very surprising when people were like, oh, this or that and the other. We had an architect in Montreal who really, really connected to, you know, the fact that A, the protagonist is an architect, but also what she's designing and where she's living, and was just so, it was so relevant to him and so meaningful to him. And that was really meaningful to me when he was talking about it afterwards.
I think that always the challenge is to dream, but to dream practically. I don't know, sometimes I feel like I dream too practically, but it's and I think when you write something, maybe it's easier to kind of embark on things, but that are hard to execute. But there's something about making it and immediately thinking you're actually going to make it, and kind of thinking a little bit more like a maker, that everything needs to actually be able to be executed, and executed, you know, right now or very soon. So
with the limitations.
Yeah, with the limitations. I mean, I think the limitations are the best. I mean, you have to fence things in order to grow. It's always about.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that like what's interesting, filmmaking is like sculpting, except that you don't always choose the tools that you're handed to sculpt with. So, you know, like you need a chisel and somebody hands you a sledgehammer. You're like, okay, well, that's not what I needed, but okay. Right. I'll see what I can
do. We're like, we want a poodle. We really want a poodle. And then... Well, there was a poodle and it was very small. Nancy was her name. I forgot her name, but she came completely shaved also. Although the whole thing was that we wanted to do the haircut, you know. And then we found this amazing lady that had five Westies. So they all, you know, they all performed, which was great because the animal well-being was really important too. So they could all switch. And then in the end, she was casted as a, the assistant for the dog groomer, because she had such a great look. I was like, can you be in? So she was she was in it. So that's the thing. The Westie ended up being not the poodle, but you work with what you got.
Exactly.
When did the dog groomer kind of become a significant element within the scenario of the film?
Early on.
So that
I think the thing that became the addition was the performative elements of the dog groomer. We always knew it was going to be a dog groomer. What emerged out of the process was the performative nature of this dog groomer, that she's a dog groomer, but she's also performing an act of some sort. And she's got these personas and characters that she goes into as she does the dog grooming, or and then it becomes more absurd and even less about grooming ultimately. I think it's about these things where I think so much of this work is what's nice about it is that you build things, but also you allow things to fall apart. So you're not holding on to these sort of solid concepts that everything in the film is both there and falls apart at some point to some extent.
But maybe the character of the dog groomer, that's symptomatic because in a way she unravels right through the...
Right. And I think when we casted Junie Kim, and she's a very good actor, and she was able to perform all these different personas and all that, and we realized, which I'm happy in the end, that it's not about so much like this fetish of, you know, the hair and the shampooing and all that. It's about the performance and what she does, and that in a way made us rely less on, you know, the more ASMR-y stuff and have to compensate because we didn't have that on her performance, which worked pretty well.
And could you talk a little bit about how, I mean, it seems the film kind of just moves kind of very subtly between different genres. It starts off with, I mean, it's futuristic on one level, but there's a kind of almost like a powerful sense of realism in the opening section, quite paced, quite slow. You really just want to show the daily habits of the architect. And then it kind of goes on this kind of narrative arc. And then at the end, it comes back to another kind of realism, you know, when...
Yeah, I think that Marie could talk more about that. But I think Jean Dillman, you know, Chantal Ackerman was a big influence. Right. But we tried to pitch things just jokingly. We're like, Jean Dillman in the future meets being John Malkovich was the kind of mash up. And some David Lynch, you know, in the end. So I think definitely, I think for me, it's always interesting to work with the structure rather than completely buy into the fiction. It's always about how do you mess with the viewer? How do you make them self-conscious of what you're like manipulating them to, then it doesn't become a manipulation. In a way, you're being honest because you are kind of messing with expectations of, between genres. So it is more about like the structure than about the story as a fiction, as its own thing. It's this relationship with the viewers.
And I think there is this notion of, you know, playing with this idea of what is ritual, right? You could look at ritual as a trap, and it is. Sometimes it's sort of the routine as a trap, the routine of your life, the rat race, if some would call it, you know, and then you also look at ritual as salvation, this routine as a thing that actually survives. And I think throwing the pandemic at it, you really sort of brought out these two notions that you have routines that you want to shed, that you are truly trapped with. The life circumstances have imposed on you. And then there are the routines that you need in order to survive the life circumstances that are imposed on you. And this dance between this that we all shared. I mean, again, coming back to this shared experience that we all had, which is like, I love my routine. The routine is getting me through the day, you know? And then, oh my God, if I have to do this one more time, I'm gonna like kill myself, you know? And sort of this ebb and flow between perspective. And once you realize that, I think the notion of actually creating characters and having characters move through time and space, that those things are intertwined for me, within any story is that you begin to create these aesthetics and these movements and these sort of, environments where timed in a certain way in order to allow these visceral experiences that so many of us have to come through without having to say it. You know, by simply just allowing an audience to sit through this experience, they begin to recognize themselves and their own relationships to these things, either consciously or subconsciously, but they feel it. And I think that's comes to the structure of it. And I think I sort of alluded to this earlier, but sort of I was really trying to figure out what is, you know, when you're trying to write a script, you have to, structure is really critical. And how do you structure a script and what is the flow of the narrative? And the form was this sort of Chinese poetic form called Kisha Tengetsu that very commonly Miyazaki uses in his animations and is used very much in anime in Japan, which is a four-act structure that has a very sort of an interesting, long, slow arc and build and then sort of tapers off rather than, you know, the sort of this bell curve that is the Western storytelling methodology that's sort of driven so much by forced conflict. Where this allows for just very mundane conflicts and just conflicts that exist that you coexist with. It's solo conflict, if you would, Kisho Tengetsu, in some ways, to really sort of permeate the narrative and the characters. And that was the form, and I think so much of the structure that you're talking about, where it begins with realism and ends with realism, but also ends beyond
realism. Not really ends, like some way. Goes back to realism and then ends.
It goes back to realism in order to get to another place entirely. That came out of that form, which is a very beautiful form, and it was lovely to work with.
And the everyday structure that you're talking about, and then how, I don't know, the smallest thing, you know, could set one off, and like nothing really happens, but it seems like, you know, the whole world kind of collapsed. For Unwako. So really, how the digital, like this cold kind of digital world becomes very emotional and very warm in a way, and very heartfelt. But it's nuanced and yeah.
Well, you know, I don't really find that the film tapers off as such. I mean, it builds to a kind of a pretty kind of powerful climactic moment, right?
Yeah. For the sequel, yeah.
Oh. Okay, so anyway,
no, I'm kidding. No,
well, there is something kind of curious right at the end, where you have this kind of maybe it's a coda, an animated coda, with the octopus. So what's going on there with the octopus?
We have signed an agreement between us not to talk about it.
All right.
Right, but it is genre-wise, we wanted to make a sci-fi. So my head was like, okay, sci-fi, you know, it has to be some kind of an alien. So it's it's a tentapus, and you know, it's supposed to be in a different universe.
But we had a type of sci-fi. We wanted to make sure we touched the other genre.
Yeah, we wanted to touch, yeah, this
maybe I could make a little guess about danger. What it's to do with, which is
that's what we do. We're always asking. Well, we've always answered that question is, what do you think about it? What do you think it was?
Very particularly about touch, and that's thinking through touch.
Right. It's true. I mean, it is five. You know, it's a five. I mean, that's just more structural. So you know, things have these parallel, and so there's connections. They're not story connections. They are structure connections, and But
yeah, I mean, I think that the things to pay attention to, without having to answer anything, is that it's a pentapus, not an octopus. So for whatever that's worth, and then you know, and then you can sort of try to think about how these things connect with each other, but they mean even different things to us at different times, you know, and that I think is what you hope for, is that you have a living work that continues to morph and shape and begins to tell its own story as it goes out into the world. And
And I think that's a very nice place to end our
conversation. Yeah, I'm sorry. There's a poopy diaper there. And two 10-year-olds are attempting
that's the best
to
way
change
to end it.
And I think that I need to go rescue.
Let's just keep that off screen for the moment while I say thank you both very much. And thanks so much for this amazing film you've made together, and for sharing some of your thoughts with us today.
And thank you, James, for being such an ally and a partner. We wouldn't have made this without you,
and patience,
for your patience. And we're just so, it's really amazing to have this opportunity to show this so in so many different places around the UK. And we're excited to hear from people. So please find us online or elsewhere and tell us what you thought and what you think the Pentapus was about.
All right. Thanks all. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.